Paulo Pinto. I'm the head of the representative office of the Minister of Foreign Affairs here in Porto Alegre. On behalf of the Minister of External Relations of Brazil, I would like, we are very pleased to welcome in Porto Alegre the United Nations Outreach Mission. I extend my warmest greetings to all UN staff represented here today. I would also like to thank Unisinos for kindly offering this venue to host the mission. We have divided the mission in four different briefings, and I must say that the interest of the public in taking part in the briefings was tremendous. All places were filled quickly, according to the order in which the requests were received, and unfortunately, many people could not be accommodated. Those without places were informed, though, that the presentations will be made available to the public at a later date. This outreach mission aims at increasing the number of Brazilians working for the United Nations. As you may know, Brazil is one of the main contributors to the UN labor budget and plays a pivotal role in providing troops for the UN peacekeeping missions. Nevertheless, Brazil is still underrepresented in terms of the number of its citizens working for the UN system as a whole. We also hope to attract both middle-level and senior professionals to the many possibilities of working for the UN system, starting this year or next. Finally, we hope to generate some enthusiasm among university students so that they will start considerably early in their university experience, applying for a UN job in the future. I wish you all a very successful meeting. Thank you.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Gabriela Mezzanotti, and I'm coordinating right now the International Relations course. It is a great pleasure to welcome you all here to this wonderful event, the United Nations Outreach Mission. Thank you all for your presence here today. In the name of Unisinos and on behalf of the International Relations course, we are proud to have a UN event here. Unisinos Jesuit Humanism prints the education we provide here and makes us compromise to the main UN ideals. Currently, Unisinos holds two UNESCO chairs, the UNESCO Chair in Labor and Social Solidarity, and the UNESCO Chair on Human Rights and Violence, and one chair from the International High Commissioner for Refugees, the Sérgio Vieira de Mello Chair. We are very proud to develop here in Rio Grande do Sul important academic research and social assistance in these areas of studies. We Brazilians can already be proud of all roles we play in the UN system. But we are being given a different opportunity here. One to show the world our creativity, kindness, flexibility, intelligence, and other qualities that many great Brazilians have shown before us. Like Sérgio Vieira de Mello, Antônio Augusto Cansado Trindade, Francisco Rezec, and others. May we find in this room talented people who will make history and help the world towards a more peaceful future, with better understandings among the peoples. May the works begin, and may the United Nations Outreach Mission here at Unisinos succeed. Thank you. Thank you.
Okay, so good morning to everyone. I do want to thank the Ministry of Foreign Affairs for having us, as well as the university to host us today. So we're going to do the session in English. Is that okay with everyone? Yes? You had breakfast, you had coffee, tea. So we want your full concentration for around 2.5 hours. So my name is Marta Elena Lopez. I'm a Colombian. I joined the UN system nearly 30 years ago. I joined first the World Food Program. Then I moved to UNICEF. You know about UNICEF? I hope so. Then I moved to UNDP, and I have two colleagues that currently one is working in UNDP and another used to work in UNDP, and currently I'm in the UN Secretariat. The way I joined the UN is different to each one of us. There was a vacancy announcement in the newspaper. I applied, and I was in a certain way fortunate that just with one application, I got in. Others have to apply many, many times, and you will see one of us. So each one joins in a different manner. So am I being clear? Can you hear me? All right. So we need your full concentration. You do not need to take notes. The presentations will be posted in the website of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. And I understand this is being taped and transmitted to other of your colleagues who are not able to join us here today. So I do thank them also on behalf of the team. So what we're going to do first is give you a presentation on the different career opportunities within the UN system. Then we'll give you some tips on how to prepare a good application. And who likes job interviews here? Who does not like job interviews here? Hands up, hands up. Okay. So by the end of the morning, we hope that you will love job interviews, because unfortunately, to get a job, normally you have to do a job interview. And then we'll open it to questions and answers. Is that okay with you? Any burning question now? No? You're sure? You're ready to start? So as I said, you will have the presentation on the Ministry of Foreign Affairs website. So in this map, you will see the different UN system organizations. Depending on your background, you may be able to apply to all of them or to some of them. So you have funds and programs that are mainly the headquarters are based in New York, UNDP, UNICEF, UNFPA, and the UN Secretariat. You have specialized agencies, headquarters normally based in Europe, like for example in Geneva, WHO, WMO, who knows what is WMO? Yeah? The World Meteorological Organization. And then you have in Rome is the headquarters of most of the food agriculture organizations. You have FAO, WFP, food, as well as IFAD. So when you're looking for a job within the UN system, explore each one of them. Today we are going to give you an example of UNDP, UNFPA, and the UN Secretariat. But we are not the only options. Explore UNESCO. Explore the World Maritime Organization. Is it clear? Yes? So we have a number of organizations worldwide. So what are the career options? So the main way of joining any of the organizations is by applying to a position. Those positions are advertised in our different websites. Most of them are at the P3 level and above and do require 5 years of experience or more. How many here have more than 5 years of experience, professional experience? A few of you. The others, no. It doesn't matter. We'll give you other options, or otherwise, we'll give you recommendations on how to prepare to get ready. So those are the generic vacancies. Then we have language competitive exams, and those are for the interpreters, translators. For the young talent, we have the Young Professional Program in the UN Secretariat, and in UNDP, for example, there is the LEAD Program. Each organization have for young professionals their own program, which is for you. Then there's locally recruited staff. Those are those who do not need to travel to go and serve the United Nations. And here in Brazil, we do recruit a number of locally recruited staff members, particularly in Brasilia, but we do have some other locations, like, for example, in Rio. Then we have individual consultants and contractors, and we will speak to you in a minute about them. And then finally, we have internships and volunteers. So who we are? The four of us, we are international civil servants. We serve all the member states. In the case of Susan, Lynn, and myself, we serve 193 member states. Here we have representatives from the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. They are national civil servants. They serve the government of Brazil. So we are both civil servants, the Ministry of Foreign Affairs national, we are international. So we are public servants also. In the case of the UN Secretariat, we are the largest organization. We have around 44,000 staff members, around 40,000 also individual contractors and consultants. And as was indicated a few minutes ago, we have troops all around the world serving our peacekeeping operations. And they can count at one point in time in more than 100,000, and Brazil is one of our main contributors in there. Where we are, the UN Secretariat, UNDP, UNFPA, UNICEF, UNHCR, we are all around the world. And in this map, what you will see are the main locations for the UN Secretariat. We have major headquarters, and we also have tribunals, for example, and we also have regional commissions. There are some organizations that are very small, and they mainly have positions in the headquarters. Which is the oldest organization of the UN system? Oldest. Guess. IMF. Not necessarily. Go back in history. No? Anyone at the back? UNICEF. Okay. I'm going to have to wake them up. So, anyone here? Guess. The Security Council? Not necessarily. Anyone here? You saw our film. Oh, okay. All right. He cheated. Okay. So the So I'll do you a quiz after. What's your name?
Rodrigo.
I'll remember you. All right. So Rodrigo, I'm going to keep an eye on you. All right. So the oldest organization is ITU, is the International Telegraph Telecommunications Union. It used to be the Telegraph Union, and it was established in the 1860s. And when the UN was created, was established, they joined as a specialized agency. So that's the oldest organization. So what can you do for us? In the UN system, all organizations, we are looking for IT experts, public information, communications, administrators, logisticians, human resources experts, legal experts, all of us are looking for those professions. However, for some organizations, we look for very specialized areas, and for others, there's only one organization that may be looking for that area. So let's give an example of the UN Secretariat. We look for cartographers. WMO, the Meteorological Organization, also looks for cartographers. But UNICEF does not look for cartographers. Is it clear? Are you starting to get the gist of it? UNDP, UN Secretariat, we look for electoral experts because we do help countries in organizing their elections in different ways. UNICEF does not have electoral experts. The UN Secretariat and UNFPA has demographers, statisticians. UNDP does not have demographers. So depending on your background, you will have to see which are your options throughout the UN system. Is that clear? Good. So now I'm going to turn over to Susan.
Thank you, Martelena. And good morning, everybody. I'm so happy to be here and to meet you all. As I told our audience in Brasilia, this is a very special trip for me. Not only do I get to meet everybody, but it's my first time in Brazil, and it's also my first time in South America. So it has double excitement for me this week. So I work with Martelena and Lynn in the United Nations Secretariat. And I work in what I feel is a very special place in the Secretariat called United Nations Peacekeeping. Has anyone heard of peacekeeping? Raise your hands. Great, almost half of you. Well, I find peacekeeping a very exciting place to work. As young professionals, potentially, I think it's somewhere that you can consider a little bit later into your career. In the field, we typically take people with at least 5 years of experience gained after their first level degree. And the reason for that is we like our people just to have a little bit of experience before they join us in the field. And that is because we work in a very rapid environment, sometimes a little bit of a more unstable environment compared to what you're used to. And we need people who can really hit the ground running in terms of their skills. So that little bit of initial work experience really is beneficial for us in the field. But I think it's important that I tell you about peacekeeping, because if you do come and join us, regardless of if it's in the United Nations Secretariat in another department, or if it's with MARI in the United Nations Development Programme, or in UNICEF, I think you'll find your way eventually into a peacekeeping mission one day, even if it's just for a few weeks, a few months, or a few years. As United Nations staff members, we have to be very mobile, and we have to be open to traveling to different offices around the world. So I'd say that if you come and join us eventually, you may end up in one of our field locations. So a little bit about peacekeeping. We're very busy right now. We have 28 operations going on in the field, mostly in Africa. That's our main continent of peacekeeping operations and special political missions. But we also have operations in Haiti, the Middle East, and Asia. We've actually just recently successfully closed an operation in Timor-Leste, where you could have used your Portuguese language skills. But we still have a mission that uses Portuguese in Guinea-Bissau. Now, does anybody understand the difference between a peacekeeping operation and a special political mission? Raise your hands if you do. Great. Maybe there's a lady over here. Do you want to tell everybody? Why don't you tell me what your understanding is?
Well, my understanding is that peacekeeping doesn't involve interference. Whereas in a more political mission, it works towards this goal to help establish, you know, better political institutions.
That's definitely one difference, but I'm looking for the major difference. Anyone else? There's a gentleman here. Think in terms of the people, the UN people on the ground.
Well, peacekeeping is more of the, on the ground, more than the military profile. Political could be different stakeholders.
Exactly, he's got it. So that's the big difference between a peacekeeping mission and a special political mission, although the lady was absolutely right. A peacekeeping mission usually operates in a big environment. They're usually bigger operations and special political missions. They have a much larger staffing component to them in terms of civilians like ourselves, but also uniformed personnel. And by uniformed personnel, I mean military troops and police. And the reason why we have military troops and police is because the United Nations doesn't have its own military or police. So we rely on the contributions of member states such as Brazil to help us with this. And Brazil is a very prominent contributor of troops and police. Our numbers fluctuate. I think right now we have 112 contributors of military troops and police to peacekeeping missions, and Brazil is in the top 15. So that tells you how important and what a pivotal role that your country plays in our operations. So peacekeeping operations have a military presence. They're usually in bigger countries where there's been very major conflicts, and the country's either going through the conflict or just in the stages of emerging from the conflict. So we need these military troops and police just to observe ceasefires, for example. But in special political missions, which tend to have smaller staffing within the mission, they're a much smaller operation. The country has long emerged from the conflict and is rebuilding itself. And we have police that come in to, say, carry out capacity building with the local authorities on the ground, the local police authorities, to help them rebuild themselves, but we don't have that military observation presence. As Marta Lena says, we have 193 member states that we work with. We have a huge budget. It's anywhere between $7.5 to $8 billion per year. And at any one time, our total military, police, and civilians can reach as much as 115,000 in the field. So we're a very big part of the UN Secretariat family. And our biggest mission right now is in Darfur and in Africa. We have around 25,000 uniformed and non-uniformed personnel there, which actually makes it our third largest duty station in the Secretariat right now. Okay, so you're probably wondering, when you've gone out and you've gained some work experience and you come to join us in the UN, where you could possibly fit into peacekeeping and special political missions one day. And let me tell you, there's a lot of different options. I think that everybody in this room can fit in one day at some point. We have two different parts to our mission operations. We have one part which is called the substantive part, and that's your typical profiles such as a political affairs officer, a human rights officer, humanitarian affairs officer, civil affairs officer, and so on. And then we have the bigger part of the mission operations, which is called the mission support component. And that's everything you can think of in terms of the day-to-day running of any kind of field operation that we have, such as aviation experts, finance and budgeting experts, human resources people like ourselves, logisticians, procurement experts, everything that you can think of that has to keep an operation running on a day-to-day basis. So you'll see there's lots of different ways that you can fit into the peacekeeping family. Now, how do you come to apply for a job in the field with us? Because we're a little bit more unique and we need to have people readily available to select and to hire, we build rosters. So a couple of times a year, once or twice a year, we'll advertise what we call generic job openings. So we build a profile of the kind of people that we're looking for. But it's a generic profile because we have 28 different missions and it would be impossible for us to recruit specifically for every single one of them. So we give you a generic idea of what we're looking for as a human rights officer or as a human resources officer or as a finance officer. And we also reflect in those generic job openings the functions, qualifications, skills and competencies that we're looking for in you, that we think that you need to have to come and join us in the field. We advertise everything for around 15 to 60 days online on the website that we'll be showing you today. And if you're placed onto our roster and you've gone through our assessment process, that's really great because once you're on the roster, you're on there indefinitely. So there's nothing to lose by applying and everything to gain. Sometimes we can't find the right people for the rosters, or sometimes we have a peacekeeping operation or a special political mission that has very particular skill set. Maybe it's a specialized linguistic skill that we're looking for, such as in Haiti. Sometimes we need one of our substantive people, like a political affairs officer, to speak fluent Creole. And these people are not easy to find. So when we think that we don't have what we need in terms of skills and competencies on our rosters, we'll open up something called a position-specific job opening, where we'll tell you more about the skill set that we're looking for. But I think that's enough from me for now. You'll be hearing more from me later. And I'd like to pass you back to Martelena.
Thank you, Susan. So now, before I turn it over to my other colleagues, we're going to just quickly go through the language examinations. So is anyone here an interpreter, a translator, or studying to be one? No? Do you have friends that could be one? Do you have family members that could? So you're going to be our multiplier. So I'll go very quickly through this. So for the language positions, we do need you to take an exam. And for the language positions, we need you to know at least 3 of the official languages: English, French, Spanish, Chinese, Arabic, or Russian. To be an interpreter or translator, you will need to have one of those main languages and be able to translate or interpret to the others. These language requirements do not apply to the other positions that Susan has been indicating or Mary will be indicating. We do have language requirements, but not as strict as these requirements. You have to understand that our interpreters, after some time with us, will be interpreting for the Security Council. We cannot afford any political incident because of an interpretation. All right. The minimum requirements are to be 55 years of age or under, have a university degree. It can be any degree: engineering, biology, theology, legal, doesn't matter the degree, but you have to have a university degree. In the case of interpretation, you will need to prove that you have 200 full days of interpretation experience, and then you will need to take the exam. These exams are announced on our website. So on this note, I'm going to hand over to Mary, and as she comes down, guess from where is she? Sweden. Don't speak. It's a surprise. Huh?
Norway.
Good. Not yet. Another. Rodrigo. You watched the film. You cannot speak. Ukraine. Anyone else? I'm keeping an eye on you, Rodrigo. Germany. Huh? Finland. Okay, so over to Mary.
So hi everybody, my name is Mari Pesonen and I'm from Finland. I'm the youngest one of the group here, although Lynn obviously doesn't like me to say that. But I'm more close to your age, so I'm just gonna tell you my story as well, because it's not that many years ago that I was at university, and I assume that you are all university students here. So just to share with you my story, one example of getting the UN. Before I start, I would just like to get an overview of the areas of your study. What do you all study? Is it all international relations, or if you just shout out what you study? Anthropology?
Engineering?
Yeah. Agricultural sciences, great. Journalism? Law? Great, okay, so we have a whole variety of profiles. That's excellent, because that's exactly what we're looking for. Myself, I studied international relations and political science, but I work now as a human resources analyst in New York in the United Nations Development Program. I actually started my career, I specialized in university in international organizations, and I started my career doing an internship for the European Union. And that's how I ended up actually working for the UN as well. And by coincidence, I just I was basically asked to help out in human resources area, and that was never my goal. I never thought about actually having a career in human resources, because I always thought that if I study international relations, I'm going to be some kind of social affairs officer or political affairs officer. There are so many other paths that I was planning that I would take. But once I got the opportunity to work in HR, I was working in recruitment, and I noticed I actually really enjoy it. And then I managed to compete against some other people, and I actually got a good job for the European Union doing HR. And then later on, after a couple of years doing that, an opportunity for me came to work for UNDP. So this is just an example to say that look broadly in the opportunities that there are in the UN system, because although you might study law, for example, it could be something totally different that you're gonna end up doing. We're gonna share, I think Lynn is gonna talk about her background as well, and we all have different stories. So it's not just one path that you have to take, there are multiple opportunities. And that's one great thing about the UN. How many of you know what UNDP does? Do you know UNDP? Yeah, good. We have a presence here in Brazil as well. So we are the social and economic development organization of the UN system. We have the mandate for that. And we really work with the governments and communities on their own solutions for development. We are the biggest or the most spread out UN entities. We are on the ground in 177 countries and territories. And while I talk about UNDP, this is just one example of the agencies, funds, and programs that we have in the system. As Marcelena mentioned, there are different organizations. There are more than 30 organizations that you could consider working for. UNDP is just one example. I obviously work for UNDP, and I love it, and it's a great place, but it's just one example where these opportunities exist. And if you're interested in working for development, if you're willing to go to a hardship duty station such as Afghanistan, South Sudan, and really work on these important matters, then UNDP is the right one for you. At the moment, we are around 8,400 staff members in UNDP. Out of these, around 2,000 are internationally recruited staff. So these 2,000 people are the staff that basically rotate. They go from a different duty station to another one, and they are expected to have an international career. It could be that they are based in New York, for example, for 10 years, depending on the profile, but the assumption is that they are international professionals and they go from a duty station to another one. In addition to that, we have around 6,000 locally recruited staff members. So here in Brazil, we have around 50 Brazilians working for us. In addition to all these, we have lots of consultants. Lots of the work that UNDP does requires short-term assignments, so we have lots of consultants that are not actually staff members, but they are engaged with us and they work on a short or a longer period on a specific project. For example, it could be a submission of a paper, and this is something that once you're closer to completing your studies, or once you've graduated and you have some prior experience, the consultancies for UNDP are a great way to get your foot in the door, and you get exposed to the work. And Susan, out of us, actually started in the UN system as a consultant as well. So it's a great way to see if this is something for you. So what UNDP actually does, obviously we have a huge mandate because we work for development. But then our work is divided into different practice areas. And out of these practice areas, there are so many opportunities. We have poverty reduction, democratic governance, crisis prevention and recovery, environment and energy, and HIV/AIDS. You can see that these go from here to there. There are so many different profiles that actually fit under all of these. So for example, in HIV/AIDS, we need specialized people in public health, for example. We need engineers who know how to build up sustainable energy solutions. We need crisis prevention recovery specialists. We need to have people who know how to do peace building, how to mediate between different groups. We need electoral specialists to help out in elections in some countries. There are so many different areas where UNDP actually operates, so I'm sure that there will be something for almost all of you. Then in addition to all of this, we also have lots of management profiles, such as my own profile. I work in HR. We need lots of different people supporting all this work that we do. So we need people who work in human resources, who work in information technology, in audit. We need lots of auditors. We need lots of legal specialists, communication specialists, procurement specialists. So these are all other profiles that you should also maybe consider. Then in all that we do, we want to encourage the capacity development. We really want to build capacity on the ground within the governments and communities, and then we encourage women's empowerment. And then just to mention the overarching goal that we have as an organization is to reach the MDGs, the Millennium Development Goals. And every month UNDP advertises 300 to 400 vacancies. Just this week, we've had almost 200 vacancies on our website. These are positions that are available globally to everybody who fulfill the requirements. Majority of these positions are in the field. So obviously, that means that it's much easier to get a job in Afghanistan or in South Sudan or in another developing country rather than in New York or Copenhagen. About 80% of our jobs are actually in the field. So if you're willing to or if you think that UNDP is your choice of career and you're really ready to go somewhere in the field, I would encourage you to, if you have what it takes, to go to one of these locations such as Afghanistan. Most of the jobs that we have at the moment, as was mentioned earlier, are the B3 level, which means that they require at least 5 years of experience. This is because the work that we do is very much advisory work with the governments. We offer them technical advice, how to use, for example, their development aid effectively. So that means that you have to have already certain skills and experience and competencies. But then in addition to this, we have the consultancies that I mentioned, and then we have other opportunities. We also have internships. So if you're interested in UNDP, it's good to keep this in mind and maybe start building your resume and then, you know, gearing yourself towards that. But there are some opportunities that require less than 5 years as well. And I think that's it. And I'll just now hand it over to Lynn, who would like to say is the youngest one of the group.
Yes, I don't know where she gets that idea that she's the youngest. Because you're not going to believe this, but I started my career more than 22 years ago with the UN. Don't I look good? I'm going to tell you a bit about my story, which is really about perseverance. When I was a law student, I did an internship in Geneva at what was then known as the Center for Human Rights. Does anyone know what it is now? The Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights. So it grew. So I was a law student. I spoke French. So my professor told me there was this opportunity to work in Geneva as an intern for the Center for Human Rights. Now, I knew nothing about the UN. I knew even less about human rights. So I went there, and it was a very good opportunity for me to improve my French and get out of New York City, and which is where I'm from. And so I spent 2 months in Geneva, and I fell in love with the UN. I fell in love with working with other law students from all over the world with a common goal of improving human rights. So after that summer, there was no choice for me. I knew I was going to work for the UN. The only problem was there was no internet in those days. I know you find that hard to believe. And I didn't know anybody in the UN, and I didn't know how to even access information. So when I graduated law school, remember, I'm from New York and I was studying law in New York, and guess what's in New York? The UN. So I made a deal with my father. I said, Daddy, how about if I work for you 3 days a week so I can work for free at the UN Center for Human Rights Liaison Office in New York. Do you think Daddy liked that idea? He said, are you gonna get a job from that? Do you think I got a job from that? Do you? Yes? No. So after a year of working for Daddy, and Daddy was not easy to work for, he's a lawyer and he was tough, I told him to fire me, and he did. And then I went and again I worked for free in Washington, D.C. at a non-governmental organization called Lawyers Committee for Human Rights. And to pay the rent, I worked as a waitress. Do you think I was a good waitress? So why am I doing this? Why do I keep, because I'm continuing to apply for jobs at the UN, but now, you know, it's not looking so good. Daddy's really not that happy. But after 2 years, in 1993, I got my first offer for a professional position in a peace operation in Haiti. And you know what I realized yesterday? The person that recruited me, he was Brazilian, Christian Daoui. So, and then the second person that recruited me was also Brazilian, Luis da Costa. So, Mileki Brazil. So my first experience was as a human rights lawyer in Haiti, on the ground, no electricity, no water, doing field work, which can be quite intensive. And I loved it. It was everything I wanted. And then my second job in 1994 was to work in South Africa for the first elections, democratic elections in South Africa. That was pretty exciting, right? Then I went to Rwanda in 1994. Does anybody know what was happening there? It was the aftermath of the genocide, and my job with a small team was to determine from a human rights point of view and a legal point of view whether genocide occurred. So that was a less happy job, and it was pretty stressful and pretty sad. But I did meet my first of a series of husbands in Rwanda. So that was good. And then after that, I took a break from the UN. I moved back to New York. I prosecuted child abuse. And then after Rwanda, after the child abuse, I'm thinking, I don't like public service. You know, I'm not changing the world as quickly as I want to. So I was at an ambiguous crossroads, and what do you do when you don't know what to do? You go back to school. So then I got a master's, and then I ended up back in the UN, which is my love. And I was in New York, and I was a lawyer, and I have had a number of different jobs using my legal skills. I've worked in treaty law, I've worked in peacekeeping. I've been an advisor to the head of logistics. I've worked on staff management relations in the Office of Human Resources Management. And now I get to work with Marta in the staffing and development. Wait, what's our section called? Strategic SP. Planning Staffing Division. Now I'm going to get fired. And doing outreach. And why do I love to do outreach? Because I can give you the information that I didn't have way back when. So enough about me. Now I'm going to our colleague from UNFPA can't be here this morning, so I'm going to give you brief information about UNFPA. Who has heard of UNFPA? Nobody. And one person. And do you know UNFPA has an office in Brasilia? No, you didn't. And UNFPA is the United Nations Population Fund. And it is a very small agency. And don't feel bad, because I do outreach with them all over the world and nobody's ever heard about them. But the reason that it's important is you see there are many UN organizations, part of our family that you may not know about, where there may be opportunities for you. And UNFPA is an organization which primarily deals with issues surrounding maternal health and child mortality and gender. They also aim, a lot of our organizations have cross-cutting themes. So you've heard of UNDP deals with poverty reduction, as does UNDP. We all work together for the Millennium Development Goals. So one way UNFPA aids in poverty reduction is through understanding the demographics. So they did the census, I believe it was a year and a half ago, where we found out we have 7 billion people. And they also ensure that women have the opportunity to choose when, where, and how many babies to have. So they provide information about contraception. They also want to make sure that during the pregnancy and during the birth, each child has the opportunity to be born alive and not have the mother die, because did you know every minute someone dies in childbirth still? They work in health areas and HIV AIDS prevention. So you're getting the picture. This is what UNFPA does. You probably haven't heard of it because it's a very small organization. It has under 2,500 people, but it's very spread out. So only 300 people work in the headquarters. Most of the other staff work in about, what does it say, 150 countries. So you can imagine the offices could be as small as one person. So they need people not just with the technical skills of, say, a medical expert, doctor, but they also need someone with those technical skills as well as the administrative skills, the ability to fix their own computer, the ability to liaise with the government and the local civil society. So of course, as in all our organizations, and we can't stress this enough, they need the typical support profiles. They need the lawyers, they need the finance, the budget, the economists, but they also need the demographers. They need health policy specialists, midwives, doctors. But again, those people that could run an office, not just be a doctor, but could also engage with the local population and advise the governments. So this is an opportunity for you to research more because UNFPA does work in Brasilia, but it also works and recruits internationally. And they need Portuguese speakers. Young professionals. Now, there's a reason I'm doing the young professionals. How many of you think I'm under 32? Okay, you're hired, you're hired, you're hired. All right, the Young Professionals Program, I think, how many people here are really under 32? You're under 32, no? Yeah, raise your hand. How many people here are really under 32? I think most of you. And how many people here are from Brazil? Is everybody here from Brazil? Anybody from another country? Okay, so you have 2 out of 3. The Young Professionals Program is something the UN Secretariat offers annually to member states who do not have adequate representation among our staff. So as you've heard, Brazil is underrepresented. So it is one of about 65 countries that we are inviting this year to participate in the Young Professionals Program. Now, this is the only way you can join the UN Secretariat if you have little or no professional experience. It is a career path. The people that come in through this competitive exam, they're like the sacred cows of the organizations. They are really. You don't have to have a career, but you have the opportunity. It's a competitive program. We offer the exam this year in 5 areas. Finance, any finance people here? One, good. 2, statistics? None? Everywhere we go, you guys, the UN needs statisticians. Any country we go to, we can't seem to find them. That's why we keep offering the exam. Law, any lawyers? Law students, okay, good. Public information, so journalists. And administration, so administration, that could be human resources, procurement, budget. Those are the 5 areas we're offering the exam in this year. You have to be under 32. You have to have at least a first level university degree in one of those areas. If you have a master's also, that's great. If you have some work experience, even better. You need to speak either English or French. You all speak English, so that's not a problem. The application period will begin June 3rd. You have 2 months to apply, but don't wait, because if you have a technical problem or if something, the system goes down in your country or for us, we don't care. The deadline is the deadline and we're not extending it. So apply early if you're interested. It doesn't cost anything to apply. We're giving the exam this year, December 3rd in Brasilia. And if you're not in Brazil, if you're in another country, most likely we will have an exam center there or close by. UNDP also has a young professionals program, which is called the LEAD program. Their requirements are a little bit higher. They require that you have a master's degree, that you speak 2 of the UN official languages. So it could be English and Spanish, English, Russian, French, Chinese. Their program right now is on hold because they are analyzing it to see if they can make it more like our program. So watch their website because it should be up and running at the end of this year. Now, I want to talk about the pay and the benefits. And the benefits are, we have tangible benefits and intangible benefits. And I've already told you a bit about the intangible benefits, the working with the people from all over the world. If you get energy from that, the ability to learn languages, to live in different countries. But we're also compensated very well. You can find our salaries on the International Commission of Civil Service website. They're public. We also, on the uncareers.org homepage, have a little compensation calculator. We have a very similar system as governments in that our salaries go according to the grade. So the P2 is the lowest grade, and they get this salary. Then it goes P3, P4, P5, D1, D2. So don't worry about the salaries. That should be the least of your problems. They're competitive, excellent pension, excellent health insurance, opportunities for learning, mentoring programs. But also, for example, how many of you would consider working outside of Brazil? Great. So if we hire you from Porto Alegre to come work in Addis Ababa, Ethiopia, which is not a bad place, we will pay for you, for your family, for the dog, for the couch, everything to move to Addis Ababa. We will also pay extra for you to educate your one or three children, depending on how many you have, in Portuguese or in French or whatever you want in Addis Ababa, in an international school. We will also pay for you to come back every 2 years to Porto Alegre or wherever in Brazil and visit your family if you want to, but you generally do, right? If we hire you from Porto Alegre to go to South Sudan, we're not paying to move the family. Why? Because it's a non-family duty station. Why? Because it's not safe. There's much higher risk. And you have to recognize that when you apply to those positions. And we also understand that, so we give you additional compensation. We give you twice as much vacation a year, which is called rest and recuperation, which you add on to your regular vacation. We will give you hardship allowance because many times there might not be running water or the water is not great or you're living in difficult conditions. We'll also give you hazard pay because it's more dangerous where you're working. We will also pay for you to visit your family once a year. You can visit them more because you're going to have a lot of leave time. But so there are distinctions in our benefits package depending on what location you go to. I personally think that I should be getting hazard pay in New York, but that's not in the cards. There are consultancies and contractor opportunities in all of our organizations. As Marie said, I think UNDP and UNICEF have the largest opportunities for consultants. So that's not a staff member, but they can be compensated fairly well also. And it's a way, without making a major commitment, to get your foot in the door, and it's generally easier to get in that way. And also, just so you know, in the Secretariat, we are mandated by the 193 member states to advertise our jobs for 60 days. We have no secret jobs. They're all on the website. But in agencies, funds, and programs, UNDP, they can advertise them every from a week to 2 weeks. So there are the turnover is a lot greater. We also hire contractors, individuals who might want to be contractors, or companies which might want to be contractors. And for companies that would want to work for us as a contractor, they would have to register, and that's a procurement process, so they wouldn't apply through staff. Lastly, but not least, probably most important for you, is the internship program. All of our organizations have internships. All you need to be an intern is to be enrolled in a graduate degree program and do an application. The downside is it is unpaid. So not everyone could necessarily afford to do that. But that doesn't mean you shouldn't do an internship. You can, as I said, I'm sure there are international organizations or NGOs or other entities, companies in this area where you could volunteer and get this kind of experience, start to make the networking, start to learn the professional skills. But if you are interested and can afford to do it or get some sponsoring to do it, our internships are minimum 2 months, full time. We give you a certificate. Our interns do real substantive work. I have a former intern who's Brazilian in going to meet us in Salvador, who helped me launch social media. How many of you follow UN Careers on Facebook? One, by the end of today, you all need to follow UN Careers on Facebook. We answer all your questions. We tell you about opportunities.
Okay, so we have been giving you some indications of different ways of contributing to the UN. The internship is one of them. And as Lynn said, it covers a number of areas and it covers the whole UN system. Another way of contributing is as a volunteer. Has anyone heard here about UNV volunteers? No? So UNV Volunteers is an organization based in Bonn. It is administered by UNDP, and it provides volunteers to all the UN system, but particularly to the field-oriented organizations. So in, for example, in the Secretariat, we have more than 3,500 international volunteers. There are three main groups here, the international volunteers, the online volunteers, and the youth program. And here's where you come in and you can contribute. The international volunteers, for international volunteers, you have to be 25 years of age or older. How many people here are 25 years of age or older? A few of you. You have to have a university degree and 2 years of experience. So here is a way of joining the UN system, and there are a number of our staff members that started as UNV and then moved as a staff member. So this is an option for you, for some of you, or in the future for some of you. So they cover, again, all the areas that we have indicated: administration, IT, communications, health professionals, all the gamut of areas. So this is another option for you. It is a volunteer assignment, but that doesn't mean that we do not pay for the travel from, let's say, Brazil, let's say, to Liberia and back. You also get a lump sum, an amount, when you arrive to settle, and you do get a monthly living allowance. The living allowance permits you to live within the duty station or the location, the city. It may not give you the opportunity to save money, but it will be sufficient for you to pay for your living expenses. Is that clear? Another way that you can contribute is online volunteering. This is unpaid. The online assignments are advertised on their website. They can be from a few hours to a few days to a few weeks. The minimum requirements is to be 18 years of age. And at the end of the assignment, you receive a certificate. It's a way of you demonstrating that you're interested in the UN. So look at the UN assignments, online assignments. In 2011, we had more than 10,000 online assignments. And finally, the youth program. One of the main concerns that the many governments are having, and the UN is having, and ILO is having, is the unemployment rate that will continue for young professionals. So UNV is launching a new program that is called the Global Youth Program, and it will be launched later this year. And it will cover individuals that are between 18 and 29 years of age. Some assignments will require studies, some assignments will not require studies. Some assignments will require experience, some assignments will not require experience. Is it clear? Yes? All right, so now while Lynn turns over to the next presentation, I'm not going to give the last slide in order to, because I want to give you time for questions and answers. So how many of you are not single? That means that have a partner, have a spouse, have a wife, have children. Hands up. Okay. So for those, no one has boyfriends, girlfriends here? Yes? Hands up. Hands up. Okay. Before you start applying, you have to discuss it with them. It is not an individual decision. Discuss it with them. So I'm assuming most of you are single, right? You do not have a partner. You do not have a boyfriend. You do not have a girlfriend. Yes, hands up. Lynn, are you counting? Okay, you have to reflect on it. Being a UN staff member is wonderful. But you have to reflect that very likely your future partner, your future husband, your future wife, your future boyfriend, your future girlfriend will not be from Brazil. So you have to reflect on that. It is important. You know yourselves, some of you can handle it, some of you may not handle it, some of you may not want that. Is it clear? Yes? All right, so I'm going to hand it over to Lynn, and she very quickly is going to give you some tips on how to apply. The tips that she's going to give you apply to any UN system organization. It also applies for the YPP, for when you present the application. It also applies for when you prepare your application for an internship. So from the beginning of your careers, you need to understand that. So over to you.
The key word was very quickly. Okay. Got it. All right. The first thing you need to do before you even think about doing an application for the UN or Coca-Cola or the Brazilian government is to do some research. Because how you understand the position and the organization is going to impact as to how you frame your application. Recruiters get approximately at the UN over thousands of applications each month. That means we spend between 12 to 30 seconds on each application. So you need to know how to speak to us. So the one thing I always like to tell people is when you're looking for a job, it's not about you, it's what you can do for me. And you need to keep that in mind when you're applying, be it with us or anybody else. Once you understand you've searched the job, sites. So you could go to UNDP and look, UNICEF and look, the Secretariat. We all have different entry points. So it's not like you just do one application and it goes everywhere. You have to go to the individual websites, which is why we keep telling you there's 30 or more organizations. Then you're going to create your profile. So this is an example of careers.un website where you could search for jobs. And in the beginning, don't just, if you're an economist, search under economics. Read a few to see maybe my skills could also be useful as a budget officer or as a finance person. So think broadly, not just about what you've studied, but how you can apply your skills to different areas. You can search by level, which level is commensurate with your work experience. You can search by location, and you can search by occupational group. You can also register on our website for certain job alerts. So say you only want to work in Addis Ababa. Every time a job comes up in Addis Ababa, you can be notified. Or similarly, you only want political affairs jobs at a certain level, you can register for that. This is just an example at our website, un.org, of all the agencies, funds, and programs. So you could go there and click. You could equally, which I think would be easier, do a Google search. Google is your friend. This is an example of UNDP's entry point for jobs. UNFPA, so are you starting to get it? Everything's online, everything's a different organization. This, you can look for the jobs, you familiarize yourself. This is the UNV entry point where you can find out about the UN Volunteers Program or the UNVs. So now you have done a little homework. You've read maybe 10, 12, 15 different kind of jobs. You're ready, you're into the psyche, so to speak, of the organization that you want to apply to. Very important to speak the language of the organization. Do you think Coca-Cola and the UN have the same language? Well, you could say, yeah, we speak English, but there's subtleties in the point when I'm talking about culture and how you want to present yourself. And by actually reading job descriptions, you're going to get insight. So now you've found a job you like, and it's in Libya as an economics affairs officer. Should you apply for that job if you don't want to live in Libya? No. Apply for jobs because it's a long process for you. It's an expensive process for us. I'm not saying don't apply to something that you think you might want, but if you know you're not moving to Libya or Mali or Addis Ababa, don't apply. But once you understand the position and location, now you're finally ready to do your application. So this is an example of where you would start in the UN Secretariat. There's, you know, a lot of IT stuff, which means you have an advantage over me, because remember, in my day, we didn't even have the internet. This is an example of UNFPA. So everybody has an online application form. Even though they're different, we're all going to ask for very similar information. So you can create some of your application in a Word document so you can cut and paste it to different application forms. We're going to ask you personal information, not because we're nosy, not because any of it's going to be used against you, but because this information will follow you along with your career, and it does impact on entitlements. Remember, I said if you have kids, you get education money. So it will all go into the final offer and your package. We're going to ask you about all your nationalities. You will have to pick. So if you have a Brazilian and also an American nationality, but you really primarily live and work or study in Brazil, you pick the nationality closest to you, but we also want to know about your other nationalities. Again, we have every single nationality. Also, we're going to want to know about your education, all your education from high school to graduate school, PhD, everything. Employment history. Now, some of you may have a lot of employment history. Like if you have 15 years employment history at one company, don't just say I have 15 years at this company. We want to know every single job and every single duty and all your salaries for those 15 years. Then, if say you have little information, the good news, you're going to be able to complete this quicker. We still want to know about your internships, about your volunteer work, about anything that you think, even if it's an unrelated job, like a waitressing job, say, that might not be relevant to be an engineer, but you also might get some skills that you could convey through that. So we want to know everything in your employment history. Languages. Even if they're not UN official languages, we want to know because it broadens you as a candidate. Obviously, you need to remind us what your mother tongue is. For example, some people will fill out their whole application in English and forget to mark that English is their mother tongue. And then the system's going to get rid of them because English is a requirement for the job. So we want to know your mother tongue. We want to know if you also speak Spanish, Portuguese, whatever, English, you know? References. We don't use references until we're ready to hire you. So it doesn't matter if you know some president or some head of a company. That's not going to help you get in. For references, what we're looking for are people that actually know you, can vouch for your integrity, can vouch for your work ethic, and who we can get in touch with when we're ready to hire you. Because if we can't get in touch with them, we're not hiring you. This is the most important part. When you're doing this either for YPP or for a real job, we want to know what your duties are in a specific position. Even if it was an intern, what were your day-to-day responsibilities? Did you research? Did you draft memos? Did you contribute to a project that a professor was doing? How did you do it? This is your duties. But we also want your achievements. So there's another section for you to talk about the results of what you did. So did anybody in this room help organize this conference today? No. Didn't nobody help you? None of the students helped you? Okay, well say you did. Okay, so three of them are helping with the TV. Get my good side. So they could say, you know, helped organize an international conference for the UN, specifically set up the TV, the electrical, the IT, whatever they did. That's their duties. Then the results were, the conference attracted, I don't know, 100 people, It went off, it was successfully received, the UN was happy, the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, whatever. Are you getting the gist? The results are your achievements. It doesn't have to be that you changed the world, but we want a specific, detailed, concrete result for whatever your activity is. The cover letter. This is what I call the cherry on the sundae. This is the most important part, because say we have 1,000 applications and pretty much everyone has the same experience, the same education, give or take. We want to get a feeling of how you are. So it is critical that you tailor your cover letter for the specific job that you're applying for. We encourage you to apply for 30 jobs at a time, but you can't just send the same cover letter. For each and every job, you have to spend the time focusing on how your particular experience relates to the specific job that you're applying to and what you can contribute. And if you don't have practice writing cover letters, you can look, you can Google model cover letters, you can go to your career center. This is what most recruiters are going to really look at. They're also looking at it to see your drafting ability. How you write is very important. Now, we know that English is not everybody's first language, so it's not that if you phrase something in a unique way, that's going to hurt you. But we are looking for standard grammar, clarity of thought, good ways of persuading us that you're the right person for the job. The easier you make it for a recruiter, and be it with the UN or anybody else, to see that you really match, the better. And that's the cover letter. Just remember to proofread, do it in Microsoft Word, spell check, and I would say this to someone if their English was their first language or their 34th language. A lot of people don't go that extra step, and that gives us an indication that they're not that serious. We had someone who spelled their degree wrong, a Connor mix or something like that. So do have someone help look at it so you get fresh eyes. Gracias. And now, because you did such a good interview, PHP, Marta is going to call you for an interview.
Okay, so have you understood what you need to do? The starting point is you need to reflect whether you want to work for a UN organization, and then you have to do a good application. Remember, we receive a good number of 1,000 applications for one position. The outside companies are just the same. So you need to prepare a good application and spend time in it. Is that clear? All right, so let's suppose you did an excellent application and you're called for an interview. Some of you said that you loved interviews, right? Good. So in the UN, the way we do the interviews is for us, it is extremely important to be sure that you have your academic credentials. It is very important for us that you have the substantive skills, IT, law, international relations, journalism. That is extremely important. But equally important is for us to know how you can integrate and behave in a team. So we want to know whether or not you can work in a team, whether or not, depending on the job, you are creative. Let's say for UNICEF, for the greeting cards, do you know the greeting cards, the Christmas card? For that division, you need very creative people. Not for all jobs you need creative people, but for some jobs you need. For others, we need very good planners and organizers. So we go from the creativity and wandering around to the other extreme of being very good planners and organizing. when we have to distribute food in some of the locations to the civil society, children, women, those distributions have to be done in a short period of time. So what's your name? Oh, do you have a nickname?
Raquel.
Raquel, okay. So Raquel, let's say Raquel, we are interviewing her for a logistician. We want to make sure that you can plan and organize, that you can distribute food so that we can entrust you with that that responsibility. Is it clear? Yes? So in the interview, where is the... So in the interview, we are going to be looking for your competencies, your skills, planning and organizing, teamwork. For a hotline, we need very good client skills. At the very higher level, we need vision, leadership, good judgment. So is it clear? So we are going a bit beyond what is your normal skills. So the way we do the interview, we will ask you to give us an example of your working experience. For the YPP, if you have no working experience, choose an example for when you're in university or even you're a sports team. Let's say we ask you, give us an example of a successful team experience. At the university, I'm sure you have to work sometimes in a team, right? So you will give that example. So we will ask you, give us an example of a successful team experience. What we would want you is to give us what was your role, what was your actions, what you needed to achieve. Did you achieve it? And did you learn from it? Is it clear? All right, what is your name?
Magda.
Magda.
Are you friends? Do you have friends here? Okay, so let's suppose both of you are friends. Okay, during the interview, I want to know about Magida, not about her friend. Is it clear? I'm not hiring the dynamic duo. I'm only interested in you. So during the interview, very often, we start saying, we did this, and we did that, and we did this, and it's very good to start like that, but after you have to switch and you have to start saying, we did this, this was what we needed to do, but my responsibility of this, this is what I did, this were my results, and this is what I learned from it. Is it clear? I'm not hiring the whole team. I am interested in you. Is it clear? Yes? And that is one of the most difficult things that we find sometimes in the interview. If we call you for an interview, prepare. Most of our interviews are on the phone. We don't have the money to travel you. So there are advantages and disadvantages on a phone interview. So what is an advantage of a phone interview? Rodrigo, you cannot say anything. You see, I'm keeping an eye on you. Advantage of a telephone interview.
You can wear pajamas.
You're right. You can wear whatever you want. What else? You would be amazed what your voice can tell you. And you will see it in a minute. Another advantage, you can read. You can have your notes, but do not read. Your voice is different when you read than when you're thinking. And we will notice it, just like that. And we will do follow-up questions. All right, so you can have your notes to remind you, but do not read, do not memorize. Another advantage. No, Rodrigo, I'm sorry. Okay, you choose the place. It can be any place. It can be the garden, it can be the dining room. Doesn't matter. You choose the place. It's the place you know. Face to face, we choose the place. Yes? All right? So, what we recommend is first that you prepare a good application, and if you're called for an interview, you prepare for the interview, second P, and practice. You can practice with your friends, you can practice with your family, or if it's face-to-face, practice in front of a mirror. If it's on the phone, practice with someone on the phone. Is it clear? All right. So I think on this stage, I'm going to ask for two volunteers. One is going to be a lady and one is going to be a gentleman, but we will choose. So I don't want all the hands up. So ladies, who wants to be a volunteer? And I can have more than one lady volunteering, and then we'll choose one of you. I have patience. I can be here waiting for someone to put their hand up.
This one.
You want to volunteer? Stand up. Okay, who else wants to volunteer? Stand up. Who else wants to volunteer? It's an opportunity for you. Only two? Three.
Yeah,
good. Good. So why did you volunteer?
I volunteer because I like experience, and I think even volunteering here is a good one.
Good. So she likes experience, and volunteering here would be an experience.
Because I think it's an opportunity for me to understand a little bit about this environment, working with you, and what about you think about my performance.
To learn and to give feedback on performance. So why did you volunteer? You were the first one.
Yes. I want to be feeling myself as a citizen and helping people in the world. I think it could be a good focus on volunteering.
Okay, so Mr. No, you know them? Are you sure? Okay, so you choose from the three of them, the first, second, or third, who would you choose?
I guess the third one.
The third one. So over to here, and thank you for volunteering. Come here. So what's your name? I remember now. Now, gentlemen. I need a gentleman. And this has to be gender parity, so I need at least three volunteers, if not more. You cannot be. Come on, one volunteer. Another, stand up, stand up, stand up. Another volunteer. Good. No more men, no more gentlemen. I can wait here. No? Okay, in which month were you born?
March.
March.
April.
April.
May.
May.
Wait one second.
This is very good.
March, April, and May.
Okay, this time I'm going to give it to Lynn. So,
my birthday's May. I don't see how to
say okay, so who was May? Come. Thank you for the other two. All right, so what do you do, Marida?
International Relations Advisor at Methodist University Center.
Good. All right. Your name and what do you do?
I'm Leonardo, and I'm an International Relations student.
Excellent. Big applause for both of them. They are going to be helping you prepare for an interview. If you take the YPP, or for example, you apply to the LEAD program or Mothers, the interview would be the same. It would be a competency-based interview. So you need to prepare. You need to prepare for us, or even if you go for a job in the outside world, always prepare. So they, both of them are brave people, that they are going to be doing an exercise to help you and to help themselves. When we go out that door, you will forget them. Mission Impossible, you get instructions, you delete them. Is that fair? Yes? All right, so can you go up the stairs and Susan is going to escort you and prepare you. All right, so they are going to answer and you are going to be the interview panel with us. Is that clear? Yes? So who's going to do it, both of you? So you're ready? You have your microphones and everything? Okay, so who's going to do go first?
Okay.
Huh?
Me.
Wait one second. Okay. I normally take a gentleman and a lady. And normally, at this point in time, most of the times, the gentleman, I ask them, who wants to go first? And the gentlemen always say, ladies go first. And guess what? This is what just had happened. All right, so Magida goes first.
Yes.
And exceptionally, you're going to have the question there. Exceptionally. Normally in an interview, you won't have them.
Ring, ring.
Yes. I'm supposed to answer the questions?
Ring, ring, the phone is ringing.
The phone is ringing.
Uh-huh. Yes.
Wait one second. Okay. You're in a telephone interview.
Ah, yes.
All right, so Mary is going to phone you.
Ah,
and
okay.
And you're going to answer.
Okay,
and
right.
And she is going to give you that question. Don't answer yet.
Yes, understand.
You understand?
Yes, yes.
Ring, ring.
Hello, Magida speaking.
Hello, hi, this is Mari Pesonen calling from the United Nations today for your scheduled interview. How are you?
I'm fine, thanks.
So you ready for the interview?
Yes, right.
I'm here in New York with another member of the interview panel, and then we have two other members of the panel online as well. We have Ms. Lynn Goldberg joining from our office in Bangkok, and then we have Ms. Marcelina Lopez joining in Addis Ababa. So we're having an interactive panel with you, and I will ask you a few questions.
Okay.
Are you ready to go ahead with the first question?
Yes.
Sure. So the first competency that we will be asking you is about teamwork, and the question is, please describe to us a successful teamwork that you have experienced. And if you could elaborate, what was the situation? Which was your role in this? And what made the team successful?
Uh-huh.
And then maybe later on, if there were any learnings from this experience.
Uh-huh. Yes, yes. Okay. Successful team for in my opinion, we have to gather people with the same focus on trying to find a solution for a problem. These people has to work together for this purpose to try to transform something that's not good in a better situation. I think these people has to have the same goals, the same purposes, and they have to help each other to be friendly, to be helpful, and okay, there's a problem, so we have to become unite to find a solution to this problem. I think this is the main requirement for a successful team.
So, as my background, professional background, I was involved in some events, okay? In these events, I have to be, how can I say, to be open to other people's ideas, and also to put my ideas, to have a position, okay, in this group. So in 2000, may I give an example?
Yes, please.
Yes. In 2003, while I was working in Porto Alegre City Hall, we organized an event called Meeting for Peace. It was about gathering people from the world to discuss about peace in the world. So it was very important because I acted with the mayor and the international relations manager to find people in the world that works for peace. So I think it was a very successful team because you bring important people and we could discuss about peace in this year. So I think the results was about many people gathering together, discussing about a subject that is always, always valid. And what I could learn about the experience is that we have as human beings to work for the other welfare. Whatever we did, whatever we do, whatever we do, we always have to think as we are citizens of the world, not just of our neighborhood. So I think I could try to participate in UN for this reason, because I think myself as a citizen of the world.
Okay, that's it. Quickly ask a clarifying question. What was your specific role in this, in the team? What did you do in terms of, did you lead the team or what was your role?
Yes. In a team, okay, I like to make communications, you know? I always, okay.
So, sorry to interrupt you, but in this specific instance, that you organized the event.
Yes, sorry, yes.
Okay.
Okay, my boss, we planned together the people, okay? And I was in charge of getting communication with these people, people from many parts of the world. So I think I could have an official communication so they could understand me, they could even accept the invitation. Okay, I think that I have the ability to make communication to people from many parts of the world. So I think the communication is, I have this ability to communicate.
Okay, thank you.
Yukira, were you nervous?
Yes.
Okay, did you notice that she was nervous?
Yes.
Did you notice that her voice changed when she was sitting back and then when she changed? Okay, your voice, even if we don't see you, tells us a million things. So don't think that because we are not seeing you, it doesn't reflect. So the question was regarding teamwork. Did she choose a good example for teamwork? When we ask that example, what we want is to be convinced that you can work in a team. So, First, the example. Was it a good example? It could have been, but it wasn't clearly explained. All right? So that's why you need to reflect and you need to practice. It was clear that it involved some people, but it wasn't very clear what was the team going about, and Mary had to follow up with her what was her role. Is it clear? All right. Are you convinced that she can work in a team? Not. A little bit, right? But not fully convinced. She started with what should be a good team. And that is okay, but don't spend a lot of time on that because we are not interested in what the book says. We are not interested in what your professors say should be a good team. At the time of the interview, we want to know about you. You have studied that. What do you do in a team? And each one of you is different, so there's no perfect answer. But what we want to know is that you can work in a team. Is that clear? All right. Susan, Mary, do you want to add anything? No?
Just to quickly emphasize that normally the interviews are 45 minutes that we have on the phone. For you and Nippy, we even have interviews just for 30 minutes and we might ask you about 5 questions. So you have to be really concise in your answer as well. It's good to sometimes give some kind of, you know, start the, before you think of a good example, you might think something theoretically as well, but then quickly go to the point. That's very important, to be concise.
All right. So, some examples are good for teamwork, planning and organizing. But the angle when you answer is different. Remember, if we say we are asking you about teamwork, we are looking to see whether you can work in a team. If we tell you, this is the competency of planning and organizing, you have to convince us with the answer that you can plan and organize. Is it clear? So the same example, this example could have been used also for planning and organizing. But then the angle is different. The role is different. This is how I planned the situation, the event. This is how I delivered. Is it clear? Yes? All right, so now we will go to the gentleman. So who's going to do this? Susan. So Susan is going to do this. So now listen again so that you can learn more how to prepare.
Ring, 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 ring.
Hello.
Hi, good afternoon. My name is Susan Huntington. I'm calling from the United Nations. Who am I speaking to, please?
Hi, this is Leonardo. Good morning.
Hi, Leonardo. Good morning. As you know, I'm calling in reference to your interview.
Yes, yes.
Are you happy to proceed, and now is a good time?
Yes, please.
Thank you. Well, today we're going to spend 45 minutes with you, interviewing you for the position. I'm joined on the telephone by my colleague, Mari Pessanen, who works for the United Nations Development Programme in Beirut. And we're also joined on the telephone by Martelena Lopez, who is my colleague here in the UN Secretariat in New York.
Great. Good morning to you all.
Good morning. So the first competency that we would like to test you on is called planning and organizing. It's a multi-part question, so please listen carefully. And if you'd like me to repeat the question, please just ask me.
Okay?
So the question is as follows. Could you tell us about a time when you've had to organize or plan a major event? And in particular, we would like to know the nature of the event, what your role was, how did you plan and organize the different actions that you were tasked to carry out, how did the event itself turn out, and reflecting back, what did you learn from the experience that you could do differently the next time?
I can think of a time back in my university as an international relations student where I helped plan with a team of about 10 to 15 other students a student meeting, a local student meeting for international relations students. Our plan was to bring several professors, international relations professors, to the city of Santa Maria, where I study, so we could learn about more, a little bit more about the field of international relations, since it was the first year that our course, our major of international relations, was happening in Santa Maria. It was the start, it was the beginning of the course, so we had to first learn really what international relations were, and then show the academic community that the University of Santa Maria was creating an international relations course. Of course, it was a big event, and we had a very good team of 10 to 15 people. I was in charge of getting in touch with professors from our state of Rio Grande do Sul and from all over Brazil, if I could, to bring them to speak in our event. And fortunately, I was able to get in touch with professors from all over the state and bring them to Santa Maria so they could give us the lectures and teach us about international relations.
Thank you, Leonardo. If I could just interrupt you.
Yes, yes,
you
of course.
You said that you had to contact a lot of the professors to bring them to the event.
Yes.
But could you elaborate a little more on how you went about planning and organizing the event and what your particular role was?
I got together with my colleagues. First we had to meet and think of what we wanted from the event, and then we divided our tasks, and I was in charge of that particular task of getting in touch with them through emails and contacting professors we already knew and people from the community that we already knew who might tell us ideas of people who could be good speakers on this. So I'm not sure if I clarified your question.
Okay, if you just like to finish the question by telling us, if you had to do all of this again, reflecting back, what did you learn and what would you do differently?
My learning from that experience was that with a small group, a very inexperienced group, since we were just starting the university, we could get together a very good and very fruitful event. And I think what I would do differently, I think that we separated the tasks too much, and I think that we should have, at that point, integrated our work a little bit more.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, were you nervous?
Oh, yes.
Did you notice he was nervous? You didn't have to see him. Now you understand your voice tells miracles. So I see some of you chewing gum. Telephone interview. I know you can get very nervous. You chew before, you chew after. No chewing gum during the interview because in the phone we can hear it. Is it clear? You can have water. Even if we don't see you, no food. No food, food before, food after. Just 30 to 45 minutes. Chips are a beautiful sound in the phone. All right? So please, concentration. If we call you for an interview, be it the YPP or be it the others, you have a good chance to do it. In the outside world and with us, the people that are called for their interview are the last five, the 10. You have a good chance to make it. so give it a good try and prepare for the interview. The question was regarding planning and organizing. Was it a good example he chose for planning and organizing? Yes. Was it clear, the example? With a bit of practice, it would have come clearer, more to the point, and all of us would have understood what exactly was the scenario. That's why you need to practice. Are you convinced that he can plan and organize? A bit, but not fully convinced. Sometimes we choose good examples, but we do not convey them properly. We do not really express what we need to express. Here, what we needed to be very clear is that he could plan and organize, and how he planned and organized. So it did come out, but it wasn't really what we were looking for. Susan had to follow up with him a bit in order to see what was his role in the whole event. So is it starting to come out clear to you what you need to look for? So if we are going to entrust you with organizing something, let's say distributing food again, I need to be convinced that in 2 hours you can distribute food to 100,000 people. Is that clear? So I have to be convinced during the interview. Susan, do you want to add anything?
Yeah, I think you've covered most of it, but I just have one more piece of advice for both of you. I was listening more to Leonardo because he was my little case study. But Leonardo, you won't have realized because you were busy in the moment thinking and trying to explain your answer. But I was trying to count the number of times you used the word we. And I counted 17 times at least. I'm sure there was more. And you probably spent 4 minutes answering the question. So just bear in mind not to use we and to use I because you're talking about yourself.
Good. Okay, so round of applause for the two. Now you can come down.